Welcome to Oneness and Wellness. I'm here with Dianne Bischoff James, and we had a first show. This is the second show of a two-part series, so keep watching. If you see the first show, wait for the second one. And we're going to be talking about the real brass ring. This is you, Dianne, as an author.
Yes.
And so I'm anxious to hear about it. You know, I don't know if our viewing audience knows about the brass ring. Maybe they heard it when they were children. You're going around in the merry-go-round and you're reaching. There's only been one brass ring and you don't know if you'll get the right one or the wrong one. So tell us, you use that as kind of an introduction to your book.
I do. The reason the title came up is because, as we talked about in the previous show, when I had this psychic intervention with Sonia Choquette, she said, if you don't grab at the real brass ring, it's going to be too late for you. And
scary.
It just, wow, that dropped inside. And I thought, too late? I mean, first of all, what happens if I don't grab at the brass ring, right? And she's like, well, you know what? You'll have to come back and do this whole life lesson thing all over again in more difficult circumstances. And I was like, whoa, I'm sorry. There's no way I'm going to redo this life and have it worse than, you know. So right. I got that message loud and clear. And then I looked up, you know, what is the real brass ring? And it used to be in the carnival that you would go around in this merry-go-round and you'd have to grab at different ones. And if you got the brass one, you're the winner. And so to me, it was just the perfect metaphor. It's about how to reach out in life and grab at as many opportunities as possible, because opportunities are everywhere. Mm-hmm. And to always look at it as, they don't all have to be the brass ring. It's just going, they used to be steel with the other ones. Those are fine too. It's just to keep breaking out, breaking free, and to get unstuck. So I used that because I just think there's endless possibilities at any age. I consider myself a midlife reinventionist.
Right, I read that. So rebooting at midlife.
Yeah. But I've had in my workshops, I had someone who was 17 years old sitting next to someone who was 82 years old, both of whom were in the workshop. And then part of the workshop, we do breakouts. And they worked together. And they loved it because it didn't matter what the age was. It
right.
was about still getting on your path.
Right.
It's about getting on purpose. It's about feeling that love, joy, and peace on the inside. And so it was just this beautiful opening for me, because I have a lot of clients who are young, my 20-somethings, and I have, you know, all the way through midlife, all the way through senior years, any years, it doesn't matter. It's about feeling good.
I think people get really stuck with age. I don't think it matters. As long as you keep reaching, you know, I can remember my mother saying, she'd get upset with me and she'd say, you're never going to be perfect. I said, it's not about being perfect. It's about growing and learning and becoming. And, you know, finally she did get that before she passed, but it was really funny. She'd get mad with me.
Oh my goodness, but you were so on target. It's all about evolving.
Right, exactly.
It's all about our growth. I say there's only two important things in life. Did you love it or did you learn something from it? That's it. So we're measuring all the wrong stuff. Right. If the question was, yeah, I got a big, fat, hairy lesson. I didn't like it. It didn't feel good. But I really learned quite a bit about myself.
Exactly.
And I was able to grow, and I was able to change. You know what? In the future, I might make some very different choices. Great. You got it. Or you could just say, I love it. Doesn't matter what it is. If you love it, like I used to love, I had a little red Saab convertible. Oh, I mean, it was just like, it was everything. Because, you know, you sit in the car, your hair is blowing back, the sun's on your face. I mean, what could be more fun than that?
I know.
So, you know.
I have a friend always, whenever he goes anyway, that's what he rents, a convertible.
Yeah. So that's it. You check that one off. You love the convertibles.
Right. That's good. Dan, I think, also had a trip. Well, that was one on his bucket list, a convertible. So tell us about the book. What does the book have? Does it have some of the shortcuts that you were talking about?
It does. It is all about the changes that I went through. So I think part of the reason that people really have enjoyed it, and I've been very blessed to have a lot of 5-star reviews on it, is because it's very personal. So it's all the dirty laundry that you're never supposed to expose is all out there. But it also includes the 14 shortcuts for happy living. And that's how I changed my life. I lost 60 pounds and kept it off for now almost 20 years. I had to change careers. I decided to become an actor when I had no business going out there and even giving it a shot. And all of that worked out well. I moved my family across the country. I found a beautiful partner. All the changes that you can imagine. And on top of all that, continuing to seek, continuing to learn, continuing to grow, and continuing to be able to afford, you know, to put three kids through college. You know,
that's a lot.
Yeah, it's a lot. It's $65,000 on top of your regular expenses. So, you know, it's expensive. And so to be a responsible parent, be a responsible adult, and also to share my passion and share my joy. So the 14 shortcuts, if it's all right, I'm going to break through and give you one of them that I really love.
Oh, no, I want you to. That's what I'd like you to do.
Well, one of the things that I think people forget is that we're in a vibratory universe. So the most important thing that we can do is to manage our wave, because we're beings of light, you know, and light moves in waves. And so sometimes I'll have clients come to me and they have this, like, you know, crazy frenetic energy going on. And typically that is either anxiety, it could be anger, a lot of times it's fear. You know, things aren't working out, I don't know what I'm going to do, you know, nothing's,
the effect.
And then sometimes it's the really low sloping, especially if it's under the line on the wave. And those are people who are very sad, very depressed. I've been there myself. I was on Prozac when I first had my awakening and got off it the day after and said, you know, I'd rather feel bad than feel nothing. Because on those medications, I just felt nothing. So I got off the next day, never took another, never took anything else except good juices. my green drinks help a lot, and getting active and just really dealing with my feelings and also learning how to deal with the emotions. So how you manage your vibration is critical. And it's very easy once you're mindful of that, because we can feel it when we're, you know, kind of panicky, or you can feel when you're kind of really slow. But the important thing is how to do that. How do you manage your vibration? So with my clients, what I always say is you have to reach for the next thought that feels better. Because in every situation, no matter what you're doing, there's some positive upside to it, that if you could just grab onto that thought, it will flip your vibration into the right mode. So for example, my daughter, this is when she was first learning how to drive. She went out. I said, great, take the car, go see your friends. Well, we were just watching TV inside. Well, she came back about 20 minutes later, and I said, didn't you already leave? And she said, well, there's been a situation. I'm like, a situation, really? She goes, well, yeah, kind of hit something. I'm like, you didn't even leave the driveway. How did you hit something? Well, she backed into our stairwell coming out of the driveway. Something that has been there forever, and she didn't see it, and she backed right into it, and she's crying, and she's like, I'll give you everything I have to, you know, to fix the car. I said, well, first of all, here's your first lesson. Number one, everybody gets a first accident. You just had yours. Please make that the last, but you know, that's fine. Everyone gets one. No problem. Number two.
And it was safe. It was in your driveway.
It's in my driveway. No one was hurt. The important thing is you weren't hurt. Nobody was hurt.
Right.
Number three, there's a thing called insurance. Yes, it's going to cost you the deductible, but, you know, for $300, you know, you'll do some babysitting and you're going to have to make that up because you have to take responsibility. Other than that, let me go out and see the damage. And it was pretty good. She got that back quarter pretty good. But, you know, I could have freaked out. She was expecting me to go crazy. She was expecting me to be upset. But it was more important that she learns these lessons, you know, that things happen.
Exactly.
And the upside is you're fine.
It's a good lesson, too. It was a good lesson for her, you know. So, you know, I think if you had treated it in a different way, you might have a different result.
Well, then she could have been left with some scarring, because some people go a little crazy over things like that. And then unfortunately, when you're young, and this is something that they don't really share very often, but, you know, they've been studying childhood development for, 20, 30, 40 years now. And they know that in the early phases of child development, there's concrete operations. That lasts until you're almost 12 years old, one of the phases. So everything that comes in from an authority figure for a child comes in as fact. So if I said, you know, what's the matter with you? Why can't you do anything right? It would go in. You know, it could go inside her and say, I'm a failure. I can't do anything right. I can't pull the car out. And so what happens is, unfortunately, those little messages get stuck. So it's very important to understand that concrete operations goes on until kids are really in their teens. And so what we say as authority teachers, coaches, parents, what we say and how we react is very important, because that's how they're creating their life lessons. You know, if they don't get stuck with those kind of messages of negativity about themselves and self-worth, they can develop more self-love. Right. So that was another important thing. So the important thing is say, okay, look, you had an accident. You don't have to be freaking out. We're just going to say, yeah, you're going to have to go do some babysitting, but we're going to be fine. We've got this taken care of. You have to make the phone calls. You have to be responsible. Manages the wave straight again. So there's very rarely a situation in which there isn't a positive thought that could be associated with it.
Very interesting, your parenting skills. So instead of getting upset, but also making her responsible for what happened.
100%.
Yeah.
100%. Because the kids also can't skate. They can't, you know, and this is the new punishment. You do this. That means put the phone right here. We don't need to do anything else. You take away the electronics, right? Anything happens in my household, the hand goes out, the phone goes in, the phone goes away. That's punishment enough, because, you know, that's,
I like that.
That's like everything.
Did you get that?
Yeah.
The hand goes out, the phone goes in.
Yeah, and you decide for how long. And the other part about parenting, which I love talking about parenting, just because I'm so blessed. I have three beautiful kids who are doing so well, and they use all the 14 shortcuts, they use the language, and we help each other. So my daughter recently called, and she said, you know, I'm having this challenge at school and, you know, situations with friends and roommates. And I said, you know what, which lesson do you think this is? And she goes, Mom, I know which lesson it is. It's that I'm always second rate. I've never been put first, and I'm working on that one. I said, exactly right. So what can we do to help you be first in your next relationship? And we use these kind of language so that she can understand. It's one of her life lessons. It's something that she's had many times happen where, you know, a person will diss her or say, I don't want to talk to you, or you're not my friend anymore. But she's learning it as an adult, like as a very young adult, you know, but learning mm-hmm. how to really see what's going on and to make new choices.
Yeah, that's wonderful. And, you know, it's you saying it the way you said it, too. You know, it's like, this is a lesson. Now, what are you going to learn from it, and how are you going to handle it? And, you know, you're really very clear in the yeah. message that you give her.
Right.
So that she's clear in what she needs to do. And that language of being first is positive. It's not negative.
Right.
You
right.
want to be first, not in an egotistical way, but first for yourself and learning the lesson that you need to learn.
Absolutely. And one of the shortcuts is how to tend to yourself. So often, and especially with women, but, you know, our energy is on taking care of the family, taking care of others. You know, it's always about the other guy.
Right.
And the important lesson to learn for many of us is how to just receive, how to choose a better relationship and say, hey, you know what? This isn't working for me. This just isn't working for me, no matter what the situation is or who the person is. And then you could find something that is a better fit. All of these are just opportunities
yeah,
for fit.
Exactly.
And it doesn't always have to be the giant drama. And the nice thing is when you're aware of what the lesson is, and this is the language I like to use a lot in the workshop, and you can see which of these nuggets you're working on, okay? For me, perhaps it was, you know, lack of, for me, a lot of it was not being Dianne the hider. It was very easy to hide for 40 years. Didn't want to be on stage. I love theater. I was terrified to write my stories down. You know, it was much easier to put the see no evil, hear no evil, and not do it than it was to actually sit down and to throw everything out there for the world to review. Now, the other side of it, and this is one of the lessons too, is you're not in anybody else's circle. So
explain.
Okay. So we all have a circle. You know, it's about basically 5.5 feet. You know, based on how tall you are, mine's about 5.5 feet up and down. It goes all the way around you. It's the only thing you have to manage in your entire life is what's going on in that circle. So I decided to write this book. I came from a family of hiders who would never expose anything. It was always about, what do the neighbors think? You know, we can't say that. You know, we can't do this. We can never talk about our truth.
We have to lie about
yeah.
that, you know, hide that.
Hide
yeah,
that. Never speak your piece. My goodness, how could you? And so I did it. I spoke my piece and I threw it out there for the world. And guess what? They didn't like it. I don't know why I thought everybody would be proud of me, but in my immediate family,
they were not happy.
Were not happy
at all. You broke through.
I broke all the rules.
Yeah.
There was an unspoken rule that you never expose anything. How could you? Why would you do that? But I did it in a way where it wasn't about calling other people out. It was about, what did I get? What did I learn from this? How did I grow from this? How did I learn how to speak my piece when I came from a family that was completely silenced? Which is challenging, which is really challenging in a healthy way, in a way where you can just express yourself. But no, they were not happy. My mom didn't read it for a couple years. And then 2 years later, she finally said, I read your book. I'm like, really? Great, I'm so happy. And she goes, it's really good. I'm like, thank you. You know, it took you a couple years, but okay. But she did, and she liked it. And I had, you know, a lot of tough feedback. But the good news is I think it's helped people, and that's the only thing that mattered to
me. That's all that matters. Can people grow from it? Can they learn from it?
Right.
You know, and I think probably your mother's generation, that was really so in the dark. Don't bring things into the light. Just deal with them.
Exactly.
And don't tell anybody about them, and, you know, just keep quiet.
Yeah, it's the gag order.
Yeah, exactly. So what a great thing that she came around and she read it and she did, you know, had something to say positive about it. That's great.
Right. And they were also the generation of being in each other's pockets, which is what we like to say. That's an old Irish phrase. Get out of each other's pockets, which means like everybody's involved in everybody else's business all the time.
And were you Irish background?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. I know.
Yeah. Strong Irish.
Oh, yeah. That's
from Kerry and
a lot
Cork,
of people come out of that, you know, and don't make the change, the transformation that you're talking about. So I mean, you're in the Boston area, you'll have a lot of clientele.
Well, part of that is just if you stay in your own circle and you get out of everybody else's business, your life becomes a lot easier. And then you also, when you're in other people's circle, you're not really honoring their opportunity to grow or make a choice. And so I think that it takes people a long time. It took me a long time to figure out how to stay out of everybody else's circle. Now, when the kids get to be a little older, you know, for a while there, you have to manage things. But we'll call each other out on this all the time and say, hey, Mom, you know, who am I to take your lesson away?
That's right.
It's really
we
kind of bold to think
That's
that you
right.
could. And so I've a couple things came up even this year where they were making a choice that maybe I wouldn't have gone for with, you know, a particular relationship. And I'll say, hey, you know, it's not my place to take this away from you. You get to learn this lesson. You get to go through this round two with the same person. You expect a different outcome. We all know that, you know, with a different person, you don't generally get a different outcome. But, you know, let them have it.
Yeah, and let them learn. You know, I have an interesting kind of a question. It's a personal question. Yeah. Do you do on the phone coaching?
Yes. I do. I have clients all over the country. I have quite a few clients actually in California because I've traveled all over. And part of the thing that's really amazing to me is the technique that I use for tapping. Do you mind if I demonstrate just a tiny bit?
No, go right ahead.
We all get stuck. And this is the part where you've had something that happened to you. It may